So in this video, we will discuss a couple of use cases on deep learning with real bioimaging world datasets. Let's imagine the following situation where you have input images and you are interested in sorting these images based on some ground truths. So this is a classification problem, which is solvable with some convolutional neural network, especially if you don't take into account any memory that would come between your different images. So which convolutional neural network should you choose? So often in bioimaging, as a non-developer in image processing, you are more interested in a solution to your problem rather than producing a new state-of-the-art image processing tool. The difficulty with deep learning applied to bioimaging is that there is no definite state of the art. So that's maybe difficult to accept, and maybe one, let's say, argue to this statement is that, okay, actually, maybe you can just have a look at data challenges which are organized in computer vision and pick up the best deep learning architecture for such data challenge and claim that you are state of the art. So, for instance, if you consider the well-known ImageNet dataset, there are some challenges organized on how to classify images among this huge data set, and you just have to pick up the algorithm, the best algorithm. So here you can see deep learning architecture, and say, okay, this is state of the art. So I will pick up this one and apply them to my own images. The problem is that if these images can be qualified of state of the art for classic computer vision, you have to understand that this classic computer vision actually includes typical natural images, which may have nothing to do with your own type of imaging. Let's say cells, if you are working in microscopy, or leaves, plants, if you are working in a plant phenotyping domain. Why are they so different? Because RGB images, which are used in these datasets, may have very different contrast from the one that you have in bioimaging, in X-ray, in MRI, in fluorescence, in depth, and so on. Also, these images are using projective geometry. So you have this specificity is very different from the data structure that you will have in flat 2D or real 3D images, where you don't have the kind of perspective inside of your image. Also, these state-of-the-art methods have been trained on extremely large data sets, typically 10 to the power of 6 instances, 10 to the power of 6 images in the context of classification, which compared to bioimaging is quite hard to produce. Or not always achieved at the same amount of data. Also, the dimension of bioimages may be much larger than images which are used for standard RGB cameras. So that's the case for MRI, but that might be also the case if you are looking from top view to individual plants, and each individual plant may have a dimension which is much smaller than the typical image that you have here in ImageNet. As a consequence, state-of-the-art algorithm for classic RGB images may not be state-of-the-art for your bioimaging modality. Since you are not providing a new architecture, it's good to compare several good candidates. And if you have a small data set, possibly interesting also to include a classical machine learning algorithm to demonstrate the added value of deep learning in your comparison. So if there is interest in real-time application, it might be also interesting to include tiny deep learning algorithm in your comparison. So in the following, I will illustrate on two recent use cases from our group, one on plant and one on medical imaging. As a first use case, we can imagine the detection of weeds in some dense vegetation from our paper from 2019. Here it's with rather a small data set. And as you see, as you can see, typically 10 to the power of 3 samples, so 1,000 samples, we took time to make a comparison not only to not only use deep learning, but also to make a comparison between classical machine learning approaches and a deep learning approach. And we also evaluate the evolution of the performance of this algorithm as a function of the amount of data. And we realize that actually, when it starts to be more than 3,000 instances, our best classical machine learning algorithm, here it was a scatter transform, would give would start to give less accurate result by comparison with deep learning methods. And we took time also to compare the performance of the proposed neural network and some light version of it. And you can see that in this case, the difference between these two were really tiny. So a few words on the scatter transform, which is basically a bank of wavelet filter on top of which a non-linearity is added and somehow mimics the way neural networks operate. But the choice of the wavelets are not learned. They are fixed beforehand based on some prior of symmetry or some invariance or scales. And so it bears some similarity with a neural network, like layers, pooling, convolution, non-linearity between each layer. But there are some differences, like predefined feature space, no need for backpropagation, so no need for huge data set to be annotated. And so far, it has been mainly used for natural images and not that much applied on real-world problem. But it has recently been shown to somehow be able to perform as good as the state of the art for the ImageNet problem. That's an archive paper from the same author, Stefan Malin. As a second use case, we will consider another classification here applied to biomedical imaging, where we have healthy and cancer images. On top is for human, and at the bottom it's for mice. Here, it's important to notice that the data set is small, but also the images are rather small compared to the typical size of what you would have with the data from ImageNet. Something like two times or four times smaller than any RGB camera taken from a smartphone. So here again, in this case, we not only limited to propose our own architecture, but also compare to standard machine learning approaches. And also we compare to the, let's say, state-of-the-art architecture for classical computer vision. So as you can see, in this case, ResNet 50, DanceNet, VGG, are doing less efficient are less efficient than our proposed architecture, which is in this case much smaller in terms of number of parameters because simply our images are much smaller than the typical images that you have in ImageNet. So the proposed architecture performs better than the state of the art in computer vision. It's a classical architecture, but pretty small compared to the state-of-the-art with RGB images. So the take-home message of this short video is that supervised machine learning is data-driven, not algorithm-driven. So you have to test your data and to talk. You have to enable your data to talk with various or interact or being processed with various algorithms to have a view on the difficulty of your problem. And don't stay with RGB computer vision state of the art only because it might not be a guarantee that it will be the best performance for you, but include them in your benchmark since it comes almost for free. They are pre-trained on natural images and also reviewer will request them from you. Study the evolution of the performance with the amount of data and include the machine learning or deep features when you have small data set. At last, take time to analyze the errors because intelligence can be artificial, but stupidity should stay human and should not go artificial. Thank you for your attention. I'm ready for questions and exchanges with you.